We are on the final part of Revelation chapter 6. We did an introduction. We did a study last week of the six seals. And today I just want to run through this whole thing because there are many parallels that I don't want you to run. It says, and Revelation chapter 6 verse 1, and when I saw the lamb open one of the seals, I heard as it was the noise of thunder, and one of the four beasts saying, come and see. And I saw, behold, a white horse that sat on him, had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went forth to conquer and to conquer. Now the first thing I want you to look at is, when a scroll is in the hands of somebody, especially when it is sealed, it has the seal of authority of a covenant, of it being sealed by somebody in authority. This scroll that was in the hands of the Lord is the scroll of authority, which is the title deed of this earth. Why was it sealed? Because the covenant was broken, and it was, the word of God says that it was written on the inside and on the outer side or the back side. What does it mean? In the Hebrew culture, when a scroll has something written, it is the contents of the deed. But when it is sealed and there is writing on the outside, it has to do with the redemptive laws that have to be fulfilled to retake that covenant. Now, we might wonder what this is all about and what it has to do with the Word of God. But what we have to understand is everything in the Torah is what comes out in the book of Revelation. If you look at the book of Numbers, Numbers 32, verse 6 to 15, you will find that it talks about a kinsman redeemer, a goel. Numbers 35, verse 16. It has to do with a kinsman redeemer, which means that the book of law, right, the Torah, has a passage there which relates to one of the same bloodline who has a legal right by God to come in and to take back what was taken by another force. Two areas, one had to do with land, the next thing had to do with the shedding of blood, and both have to do with a kinsman redeemer. And that's the role the Son of Man, Yeshua, who is God Himself, is presenting Himself as the only one who has both authority in heaven and on earth. Because it has to do with an earthly scenario, but at the same time, it has a spiritual realm to it. The forces of darkness that broke, that got man to break that covenant, was spiritual. It was the Nahash. And that is exactly what's there in Bereshit or Genesis chapter 6. It shows that the sons of God saw the daughters of men and came and did something which was, according to the book of Jude, they left their first estate. They broke covenant with God. And what the Messiah is doing now is, according to what is written as a redemptive plan to the title deed of this earth, He's breaking the seals. And the first person that the four beasts, the Zohar, shows is a rider on a white horse. And it says he was given a crown. Now, the Greek word, actually there are two Greek words for crown. The Greek word here is Stephanos, which means it was a victor's crown. Why? Because this was what was given inside the Roman arena to people like gladiators who won or won something from a conquest. That's why it says, and he was given authority to when conquer. what the Lord wears is diadem in Greek. Diadem, right, is a king's crown. It is not a Stephanos. It is not a wreath type of adornment on your head. That's the first thing. The next thing we learn is that there were four horsemen. Four horsemen, and they are destined for what? Destruction. They are destined for destruction. Now, how do we know, right, that there are biblical parallels of this destruction? Turn with me to the book of Zechariah. Chapter 1 and verse 8. Zechariah 1 and verse 8. Or let's look at verse 7. Upon the 24th day of the 11th month, which is the month of Sheba, the second year of Darius, came the word of the Lord unto Zechariah the son of Berechiah, the son of Iddo, the prophet, saying, I saw by night and a man riding upon a red horse, and he stood among the myrtle trees that were at the bottom, and behind him were the red horses speckled and white. You see, so there's a parallel. There's a parallel. Then said I, O my Lord, what are these? And the angel that talked with me, now here again, just like Yohanan, John, who was the instrument God used in the book of Revelation, here Zechariah is presented with an angelos, a heavenly messenger, to give him an explanation. Can you see how the word of God is, you know, that's why I keep saying, you know, when people keep saying Old Testament, it's a stupid thought. Because there's nothing old about God's word. Yeshua is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the Word. He can't be old. All we see from the Word of God is that it's always showing you the cyclical side of Torah. How something happens here, it turns around and comes around in a circle. Let's read on. And the man that stood among the myrtle trees answered and said, now hold on. This person who is supposed to be an angel is actually a man. Because the Greek word angelos means messenger. It does not have to be somebody with wings. And this is where the majority Christians have been influenced by the period of the Renaissance, where every painting that came out of Europe had these tall beings with wings. These guys didn't have any wings. These were messengers. You understand? It's that they have mixed up the seraphim and the cherubim. They have four wings and six wings. But most of the angels that appear have no wings. Because they don't need to fly. Only birds fly using wings in this realm. But in the angelic realm, they move from one dimension into another. So this man, right now, he's glaciers from the word of God, a man, an Adama, among the myrtle trees, answered and said, these are they whom the Lord had sent to walk to and fro through the earth. So you see, before something is about to take place, God has, I don't know, beings, shall we say beings, right, in some supernatural form, that have gone through the earth and know exactly what they should be doing. right? And they answered the angel of the Lord that stood among the myrtle trees and said, we have walked to and fro. Now, who is this we have walked? These horsemen. Truth, and behold, all the earth sitteth still and is at rest. Right? Now, stop there and go with me to Ezekiel chapter 9, and I'll show you another parallel. Ezekiel chapter 9. Verse 3, and the glory of the Lord of Israel was gone up from the cherub whereupon he was to the threshold of the house, and he called to the man clothed in linen. Now, if you take this sentence, the man clothed in linen has to do with the righteousness of God. A man wearing linen means that he's wearing the righteousness of God upon him. And you will find in Revelation chapter 19 that the raptured saints are all wearing fine linen coming down with the Lord. Angels are not wrapped in fine linen. You understand? Pick that up. Then it says, which had the writer's ink horn by his side. So in short, he is being given instructions by the Lord to write something down. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of men that sigh and cry for the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. What are these abominations? These men were lamenting, like we are lamenting today, that the church of Jesus Christ has gone astray. They have come up with their own theories, their own satanic day of worship called Sunday, which is to do with the sun god. It came from Rome. It didn't come from anywhere else. They have discarded the set appointed days of the Lord, which is Leviticus 23. They have set up their own days of Christmas, which is pagan, of New Year, right? And they have believed a lie for the truth to say this is from the word of God. But there are those people who are led by the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit of God. When they see these things, they believe in their spirit that these are things that hurt God. See, it's very simple. The Lord says, if you say you love me, keep my commands. If you say you love me, keep my commands. Mitzvot. Commands are different to what he spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai. He spoke 10 words. Those are not commands. But the English Bible says the 10 commandments. There are no 10 commandments. There are 613 mitzvot commandments. 613. Start reading from Exodus 21 onwards, and you will find from Exodus 22 that the 613 commands are thereof. So what the Lord is saying is, I have given you instructions. Why aren't you keeping them? And in the same way, here, these were a group of people in Jerusalem who were lamenting at the abomination of what the so-called Jews were doing inside the temple. What were they doing? They were baking cakes to the Queen of Heaven. That's what Jeremiah says. And the Spirit of the Lord shows Ezekiel that there were women bowing to the sun and weeping for Tammuz. Who is Tammuz? Tammuz was the demon child, so-called born to Semiramis, who was the mother and the wife of whom? Of whom? Who built the Tower of Babel? Nimrod. Nimrod, which means rebellion. Nimrod in Hebrew means rebellion. And the English Bibles have a mistranslation which says he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. He was a mighty hunter in the face of the Lord. He stood up to God and said, who are you? Yeah, that's why he built this huge zig. It's not a tower, it's a pyramid, a ziggurat. And he says, if this so-called God sends a flood a second time, we will be so high in the sky, it won't kill us. That he, in the face of the Lord, he looked God in the face. And if you read it in Hebrew, he is referred to as a Gibor. The English word says a mighty Giborim, which is very parallel to the Nephilim. Giborim. He became Gibor. So there was some satanic influence, like in the times of Noah. Yeah. That's why the word of God says that there were gigante, that's in the Greek, which is Gibor in Hebrew, before and after the flood. Before and after. It's, you know, as I said, it's amazing how we see so many biblical parallels, and people keep saying, oh, that's Old Testament. The next thing you will find out is that he was holding a bow. 99.9% of the English Bibles have translated it as a bow. Wrong. Wrong, wrong, wrong. The law of first mention has to be applied. And the first time you see this mention of the word bow is the Hebrew word keset, which means covenant. He was holding a covenant. And how do I know that this is a covenant? Because in Daniel 9:25 onwards, it talks about the prince that brings in a false covenant. And Isaiah 28 clearly says, we have made a covenant with death. And that's the covenant he's going to bring into this world. Now, we have to now divert slightly to things that are happening in the physical realm and start seeing, do we see something like this happening? The world is suddenly seeing, since 1948, the rise of the Arab nations. And with the rise of the Arab nations, there is Islamic eschatology. Now, hold on a moment. Am I endorsing it? No. I'm just giving you the facts. The Islamists also have what is called eschatology. Eschatology is a Greek word from the word eschatos. Eschatos means the things that are happening towards the end. Ology means the study of the things that are supposed to happen in the end times. And Islamic eschatology says that they are waiting for the 12th Mahdi. The 12th Mahdi. Stop there a moment. Go back to the Hebrew. What is 12? Government. So they are talking about the complete government of the world under whom they call the Mahdi, the 12th Imam. And the Bible from the book of Revelation says that he who was given rule to conquer is the Antichrist. So who is the Antichrist in the book of Revelation and the Bible is the good guy in Islam. And the bad guy in Christianity is the good guy in Islam. So it's an oxymoron. You understand? And that's what we are seeing. But the amazing thing is when you study the word of God in Genesis 8:16 verse 12, you will find, right, that this guy comes down from the line of Ishmael. Right? He comes down from the line of Ishmael, and he is from the bloodline of Kedar, which is one of Ishmael's sons. So this Mahdi is an Islamic line that comes down from Ishmael from Kedar, and he is the 12th guy. Now the other thing about Islamic eschatology is that there is a split. The Iranians are the ones who are into the eschatology. The Shiites, not the Sunnis. And the Shiites believe that the 11th Mahdi, who was there 200 odd years ago, is hiding inside a well. Take another word for well. In Greek, the abusos, the pit. What is a well? A pit. And the word of God tells us that the demon that comes out of the abusos, or in English the abyss, is called Apollyon, and in the Hebrew Abaddon, which means destroyer. And the, see, as I said, I feel very sad because there are a lot of good Muslims. When I say good Muslims, people who don't want violence, people who want to worship a one God, a monotheistic God, but they have been given a lie like the Roman Catholics for the truth. Very simple, very simple. Let's take the eschatology a step further. According to Iranian or Shiite eschatology, this Mehdi can only come when the world is on the brink of destruction. That is why Ahmadinejad wants this war. When somebody interviewed him and said, at least 4 to 5 million people will die, he said, sure, the world has to be in a state of destruction for the Mehdi to come. What is the book of Revelation telling us? The book of Revelation is telling us that when this Antichrist, so what we are seeing from the four horsemen is the very thing that the Shiite eschatology is talking about. But actually, when you look at the words of Yeshua, who is God himself, this is the Antichrist and the destruction that's coming upon the world. The next thing I want to show you is that if you go to the sixth book of the Bible, which is the book of Yehoshua, right? You will find the exact situation that's taking place in the tribulation times, right? In the book of Yehoshua. You will find that the leader is Yehoshua. Here the leader is Yeshua. You will find in Joshua 5 that there are 10 cities that come up against him. They form a confederation. You will find that there are 7 heads and 10 crowns that the Antichrist comes up with. You will find that in the book of Yehoshua, 7 fall, right? And there are 3 at the end. You will find that in the book of Revelation, 3 fall and 7 are there at the end. You will also find that the king in charge of those 10 cities in Jehoshua's time has a name called Adonai Zedek, which means King of Righteousness. So can you see the patterns? But they are actually Antichrist. The next thing you will find that what this man is coming with a covenant symbolizes peace. But actually what is it inside it? Destruction. It's exactly the opposite. Because only the God of peace, of Shalom, the God of Yerushalayim, can bring peace to this world. So this guy is coming with a message of peace, but actually what's inside? Destruction. That's the Antichrist. He's going to use supernatural power. The next thing you will find, right? You will find that as we look at the horses, another horse, the second horse was red, and power was given to him to take peace from the earth. So you see what happens. The first covenant that he signs is a peace treaty, but which brings destruction. Because it's followed by the second horse. And then he opened the third seal, and I heard the third beast say, come and see, and beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he had a pair of balancers. Why? Judgment. Outside every courtroom, you will find a woman blindfolded. Right? But actually, you know what that is? Blinded justice. It's demonic. It's a demonic sign that her justice is not righteous. It's blinded because she's not looking at the scales, no? It's blinded justice. That's why her eyes are covered. And a measure of wheat for a penny, and 3 measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil and the wine. 2 things here. The first thing is that this was a denarius. A denarius was a coin of wage given to a man for a full day's wage, which means that in the end times, that denarius, which fed his whole family, will be able to feed one man, one meal. That's how scarce food is going to be. Oil and wine is the food of the rich. And they are saying that will have to be used sparingly, even by the rich, because there will be short supply of food. Now, when you look at the current scenario of what's happening in the world today, America has been devastated, although they're not making a lot of noise about it, in their wheat supplies. Right? Huge. Huge. They have decided not to export wheat. Right? Now, this is still the beginning of things. Right? So, wheat is going to get adversely affected. When you look at what Rabbi Jonathan Carr put out about the harbingers, the eight harbingers, you will find that God is already taking America to task. Why? Because America has turned against Israel. Very simple. And it says that when you open the fourth seal, I heard a voice saying, come and see, and look, behold, a pale horse. Actually, the Greek word is chloros, which is the same name for chlorine, chloros, and his name was death, and hell followed. So, there are some Christian commentators that saying that the white horse is Jesus. Just imagine, Jesus is followed by hell. I mean, you gotta be stupid. But I'm telling you, my wife and I went for a conference in Singapore, and I walked up with this very anointed man of God, and I said, how do you get this white horse wrong? I said, well, that's the way I interpreted it. I said, the first guy comes with peace, and he's Jesus, and the last guy says hell followed him. I said, some combination of four horsemen. They're supposed to be friends. You know? So you see, you know why? Because these guys all believe in the Old Testament. They didn't look at the book of Zechariah. Very simple. Book of Zechariah is very clear. And death followed him. And power was given to him over a fourth part of the earth to kill with the sword, with hunger, with death, and with wild beasts of the earth. Now stop there. And come with me to Leviticus 26. And I'll show you that there's nothing old about the book of Leviticus. It starts off by saying blessings for obedience. But if you go to verse 24, then also walk in contrary unto me, and I will punish you 7 times for your sins. And I will bring the sword upon you that shall avenge the quarrel of my covenant. And with ye are gathered together within your cities, I will send pestilence. Hello? What does this tell you? What does this tell you? That the word of God is true. Today, the Western churches are teaching that the Torah, which they interpret as law, was crucified on a cross. No. Yeshua in Matthew 5:15 says, I came to fulfill. What does fulfill mean? To tell you that this law cannot be changed, but in me there is a redemptive plan. That's the only difference. It is by grace, according to the book of Ephesians, it is by grace ye are saved, lest any man boast. So the law is still there, and the law is being applied into the future in the book of Revelation. So it means God didn't do away with the law. But that's what the church teaches, that there is no law. If there is no law, how does God govern? He's a righteous God. He's a righteous God. Right? Turn with me to Jeremiah 25. Sorry, Jeremiah 24, verse 8, and even as the evil figs which cannot be eaten, they are so evil, surely saith the Lord, I will give Zedekiah the king of Judah and his princes and the residue of Jerusalem that remain in this land, and them that dwell in the land of Egypt. I will deliver them to be removed into all the kingdoms of this earth for their hurt, to be a reproach and a proverb and a taunt and a curse in all places, whether I shall drive them. And I will send the sword, the famine, and the pestilence among them till they are consumed off the land. What is that? Leviticus 26. Leviticus 26. It is the same applied, right, in the book of Zechariah. It's same applied in the book of Jeremiah. It is the same applied in the book of Revelation. Yeshua is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews 13:8. And the church keeps saying, no, no, this is all wrong. It's in the Bible. It's in the Bible. See, the problem is that they have taken this word called grace and said, now there is no law. Why? Because the moment you talk about Torah, it has to do with the Jewish people, it has to do with Israel, it has to do with Moses, and the church is anti-Semitic. Let's get frank about it. They are anti-Jewish, and they don't realize that the Jew of the Jew of the Jew is Yeshua, the Messiah, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And if you're anti-Jewish, you are against him. And when he says in the concluding passage of Matthew 25, he says, if you do this to the least of my brethren, he's not talking about poor people. He's talking about the Jews. If you do this, why? Because Rav Shaul in Romans chapter 1 clearly says, this basar, this good news is first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. If it was not for the Jew, why would he say it? Why would he say it? So, there goes your Western theology, right? Whew. Let's move on. And when he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how Lord, O Lord, how long, holy and true, will not thou judge and avenge our blood that dwell on the earth? Now, actually, what is that? What is that? You will find, right, that when you start looking at Revelation chapter 8, you will find that another angel came and stood at the altar having a golden censer that was given to him, much incense, that he should offer it for the prayers of the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. These are the saints who are saying, Lord, you know, we were martyred during the tribulation. We want justice. We want justice. Right? And you will find that this parallels what? The blood of the first man slain, Abel, where the Lord says the sands cry out for the blood of Abel. This is the same parallel. Where the martyred saints are saying, Lord, how long? How long, Lord? And what happens? They are given white robes. The man under the myrtle tree was wearing a white robe. Angels don't wear white robes. So can you see, if you don't study the tabernacle of Moses, you will not understand the fine linen. The perfect man. The perfect man. White robes were given to each one of them, and it was said that they should rest for a little while, for a season, until their fellow servants and also their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. And when I opened the sixth seal, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth, and the moon became as blood. Now, a lot of teachers of eschatology take this passage and tie it with Matthew 24. Wrong. Wrong. The tribulation has not begun. This is just the starters. This is the aperitif, the hors d'oeuvre, not the main course. Matthew chapter 24, let's quickly turn to it. I'll be learning something here this morning. Verse 29, immediately after the tribulation, the sun shall be darkened and the moon shall not give her light. Immediately after the tribulation. Can you see how wrong teaching gets into the church? Immediately after the tribulation. In short, this is jumping back to Bereshit chapter 1 verse 2. and the earth was without form and it was dark. This darkness that's going to come upon the earth, because there's going to be no more sun, there's going to be no more moon, and there's going to be a period of darkness. And that is the reference in the concluding passage. Nobody knows this day or the time, because there's so much of darkness. You won't be able to even look at your watch, which has luminous hands, because there's no light to illuminate it. Nobody knows the day or the hour. That's the reference, not to the rapture of the church. Wrong eschatology. Does it make sense? Now let me prove to you that there was a prophet who saw Revelation chapter 6, Joel chapter 2 and verse 34. Turn to that. Joel chapter 2. See, if you cut off this thing called the Old Testament, you won't learn anything about the book of. Just turn to Joel chapter 2 verse 1. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, sound an alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh. For it is nigh and at hand, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, as the morning spread upon the mountains, the great people are strong. Now turn quickly to verse 31. And the sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the great and terrible day of the Lord. Before. So this is Revelation chapter 6 that they are talking about, not the final day, not that final period. And when you take Acts chapter 2, this was Peter's reference as a clear sign of people speaking in tongues. He says, didn't the Lord say, I will pour out my spirit upon all men servants, that old men shall see dreams and young men shall see visions, and then will come a period where the sun will become dark and the moon become like sapphire. That's his reference. So we are taking different passages taught in different churches and getting very confused. But you won't get confused here, because I'm putting everything into its right perspective. And you must be able to quantify and qualify everything that's in the Word of God. Now does it make sense? And the stars of heaven fell unto this earth, even as a fig tree casts her untimely figs, that she is shaken of a mighty wind. And heaven departed as a scroll and rolled together, and every mountain and island was moved on to their places. What is this? Let me give you what is in the Science Today news. In 1845, they found that the North Pole had begun a tilt towards the east. That is continuing, and it's moving at a much faster rate now, because the tilt is getting greater. If in 1845 the world had tilted by 10%, imagine what the tilt is today. And Science Today says that they are expecting between December 2012, which is only a few months away, and January-February 2013, the polarity of this earth to shift. Coincidentally, the sun has a polar shift every 11 years. And they say that's going to take place simultaneously. If you take the earth, which has water right around it, and you tilt it, what happens? The water moves. So suddenly this world is going to go into a tilt, and you're going to see the stars as if they are falling like untimely figs. You see, because everything outside is going to be rushing. No, because you're rushing. You're in a case of tilt. Plus there's solar flares. So there's going to come, as I said, I don't know whether it's going to happen in December. I don't know whether it's going to happen in January 2013. But one thing I know, according to the book of Revelation, it's going to happen. But the amazing thing is, this is where false teachers of mid-tribulation rapture and post-tribulation rapture will fall flat on their arguments, because in 1 Thessalonians 5, the Lord gives us the same guarantee He gave Noah. I will not take you into wrath. I'm saving you from the wrath. Imagine the church of Yeshua the Messiah going through all of this. False peace, war, death, pestilence, and finally, death. Earthquakes, mountains being shifted from their places. How can mountains get shifted? because of the water under them, because of the lava flow, because of the earth's tilt. And the church is going to be on this earth while all this is happening. Wow, we have to be in some special capsule. And you know where these false teachers fall flat on their faces? If you go to Revelation chapter 7, the ceiling of the 144,000, you will find that they are the only people who survived that period. They are not touched. It doesn't say the church was sealed. Where is the church? Church is gone. I mean, just imagine the church that's following the Lord doesn't get sealed, but 144,000 Jews who have just accepted him get sealed. I mean, oxymoron, isn't it? Can't be, huh? Here, tongue speaking, miracle working, born again believers are on the earth and they don't get sealed. But 144,000 from each tribe, it gets sealed. I mean, you know, I don't know how these people have the brazenness to teach when it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. And they don't understand that Greek word metatauta after this. So let's just recap what's happening here. John is in heaven, chapter 4. Chapter 5, he gives an explanation of heaven itself, the throne room. Chapter 6 goes to that period where he's saying, who can break the seals? In chapter 5. And here the Messiah comes, and he's the only one who's God, but who was also created as man. Who can redeem man? A goel. 99.9% of the Western church can't understand the word goel. They think it's the prophet Joel. A goel is a kingsman redeemer. It's very Hebrew. It's very biblical. It's very Torah. Book of Ruth is all about a kingsman redeemer. And when you look at this, you will find that all of these are taking place because the world, like in the times of Noah, have rejected the God of Israel. Very, very simple. And I'm telling you, there are going to be many churches that are going to go through the period of the tribulation. Because they are playing church. They're meeting on the wrong day. They're saying that there's an Old Testament. They're saying that God has changed. When in Malachi, he says, I am Yahweh, I do not change. They're saying, no, he changed. Now, no more Leviticus 23, now it's Christmas. Now it's 31st December. Yeah, now it's Easter. I mean, the very pagan feast of sex is celebrated in the church, Easter. Bunny rabbits and Easter egg. Yeah. So God says, I do not change, but the church said, no, sorry, wrong number. Now he's changed. Now we are in the 21st century. Whereas the word of God says, I am the same yesterday, today and forever. So as I said, you know, the church or the so-called Western church wants to believe a lie for the truth. As much as Romans 11 says that Israel is partially blinded, so is the church. So is the Western church. And they are teaching people a lie. They are teaching people a lie. That's what is said. And it says that heaven, verse 14, and heaven departed like a scroll when it rolled together, and every mountain and island was moved out of its places. Where does it say that the church was still standing still? And the kings of the earth, now count, the great men and rich men, the chief captains and mighty men, bondmen and freemen, hid themselves, six groups of people, hid them in the rocks and on the mountains. That's funny, isn't it? Because the previous verse says, and the mountains were moved out of their places. So all these guys who have built concrete bunkers in the mountains are going to get moved with the mountain. And they said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. Hold on a moment. Turn to 1 Thessalonians 5. The wrath of the Lamb. I will prove to you that there is no mid-tribulation rapture and post-tribulation rapture. 1 Thessalonians 5. Verse 9, 1 Thessalonians 5, for God hath not appointed us to wrath. Now either Rav Shaul was absolutely out of his head and John is correct in the book of Revelation, and it can't be because it's the inspired word of God. And he says that the kings and the captains and the good men and the bad men and all the men of the earth are saying, the wrath of the Lamb is here, and Paul is saying, no, I got it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
It's very clear. For God had not appointed us wrath, but to obtain Yeshua's salvation by our Lord Yeshua HaMashiach. You see, sadly, brothers and sisters, the so-called church doesn't know what they are talking about. They are playing Sunday service, teaching Mary and Martha 7 loaves and 2 fishes every day. That's their Sunday sermon. Give them a little bit, collect their tithes, sing a few hymns, make them feel like a children's party, feel good factor, and go home. But the church of the Holy Spirit is a church that prepares people for the coming of the Lord. Maranatha. Maranatha. Come, Lord Yeshua, come. And how can the so-called body of Christ say, we are mid-tribulation rapture, we are post-tribulation, pre-tribulation? There can't be confusion. The god of confusion is Satan. Am I correct here? God has not appointed us to wrath. And here the captains are saying, fall on us from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath is come. It's just coming. And who shall be able to stand? Who? But the church is there on Sunday singing hallelujah to the Lamb, while everything else is, mountains are getting displaced, earthquakes are happening, famine, wars, and the church is meeting on Sunday and saying, praise be the Lord, hallelujah, and collect, make the tithe collection also. This is nonsense. There is no group of believers, because the Lord tells the church of Philadelphia, I have opened a door for you that no man can shut. And brethren, I want you to believe that if you believe that the Lord is the same yesterday, today, and forever, if you believe that his coming is nigh, if you believe that you need to polish up your act, not in righteousness because you wear his righteousness, but walk daily seeking him, focusing on telling people, my Lord cometh soon, my Lord cometh soon, prepare those who don't know the Lord, you will be taken up in the rapture. Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you. We want to bless your name, my God. We want to thank you, Father, for everything you've taught us. For Lord, Holy Spirit, Ruach HaKodesh of the living God, we are blessed. This is how the Lord asked Aaron to bless the children of Israel. Ivarekaka Adonai Vishmareka, Ye Adonai Panibileka, Vihunuleka, Issa Adonai Panibileka, Yeshemleka Shalom. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance and give you his shalom. Go in the peace and the love of Yeshua the Messiah. Amen.